no outside forces involved in the recent shakeup in the Senate. That's according to the upper chamber's new leaders, who vowed to uphold the Senate's independence. RG Cruz reports.
Senate President Pro Tempore Jinggoy Estrada declined to say what happened behind the scenes, but he made it clear Malacanang and House Speaker Martin Romualdez had no hand in the Senate's affairs. He also denies initiating the ouster of then-Senate President Juan Miguel Zubiri.
Ang lumalabas kasi na balibalita sa labas na ako raw ang nag-instigate, ako raw ang nag-initiate nitong kudeta laban kay Senator Miggs. Hindi po totoo yan. I am denying it outright. I had no hand. I never initiated or instigated the ouster of Senate President Zubiri.
Senate President Francis Escudero gave his assurance the Senate remains independent. He also urged everyone to move on and start working.
It's not so much for posterity. I'd rather focus on the unity of the Senate than the focus on what divided us to begin with. Huwag na natin ungkatin yung mga sugat na yun.
The chairmanships of the Senate Committees on Ethics and Privileges, Finance, Tourism, Youth, Local Government, Urban Planning, Housing, and Resettlement are now vacant after their former chairpersons resigned along with Senate President Juan Miguel Zubiri. There will be a reshuffle of committee chairmanships at the Senate, and all these will be decided in a caucus on Wednesday.
Some of the committee heads, chairs, already signified their intention to resign, or some have already resigned. We're referring to several committees na wala pang ulo. So in the meantime, the vice chair would be in an acting capacity as the chairman. So tuloy-tuloy din yung mga hearing.
But the changes may not be that sweeping, according to the new Senate President.
Konti lang naman yung gagawin. Konti lang.
Obviously, yung mga, in my case, I'm higher education. So obviously, that will be assigned.
A member of the Zubiri-led bloc of Senator Joel Villanueva, Nancy Binay, Sani Angara, Sherwin Gachalian, JV Ejercito, and Lauren Legarda said they have yet to decide on what to do or if they will join the minority. For now, it's clear Senator Ronald De La Rosa will remain as the chairman of the Committee on Public Order and Dangerous Drugs, which is probing the PDEA leaks. Escudero won't stop De La Rosa from investigating the matter, which has dragged the names of the president and the first lady. But he does have this advice for De La Rosa.
Depende sa chairman, pero ang pinaalala ko lang sa kanya, tulad ng pinaalala ko sa unang pag-attend ko ng hearing, walang pumipigil sa kanya maghain ng resolusyon tungkol dito para walang issue kaugnay sa procedure. Pero yung motu proprio, ito ang kauna-unahan kasi sa kasaysayan nga ng Senado ng motu proprio, nakakatatlo-apat na. So pwede niyang ituloy anytime basta maghain na ng resolusyon.
De La Rosa explained his chairmanship and hearings have nothing to do with the change in the Senate presidency.
Tinanong ko ito kay Senator Chase kung talagang yan bang dahilan bakit kinudita si Senator Miggs dahil ba dyan sa hearing. Sabi niya, no, hindi yan kasi wala yan sa rason dito. Wala yan sa rason. Yun lang sabi sa akin, ha? Which, of course, it's up for you to, bahala na kayo.
De La Rosa also shared why he was in tears on Monday. He says he failed Zubiri because of his previous commitment to his PDP Laban party mates who already went with Escudero.
Kasi yung nakapirma ako before mag-start ang session, di ba? Pumasok ako doon. Tapos ngayon, nung sinaluduhan ako ni Miggs, eh talaga hindi ko napigilan, napaiyak ako.
Alam mo, I thought I've seen strange things in my political career. And this happens to be the strangest. Talagang, kung kahapon ako po ay heartbroken, then po ako ay dumbfounded. Talagang hindi ko ma-gets, hindi ko talaga maisip, hindi ko talaga mag-grasp yung pangyayari ngayon.
Pero nag-usap
at least,
kayo.
At least alam niya, na dinepensahan ko siya bilang isang chairman ng committee. At dahil dyan, nagkaroon po ng sakripisyo, ako po yung sakripisyo dyan, nawala po ako sa posisyon.
Mum's the word on the circumstances that led to the changes in the Senate, but Escudero did say senators signed individual resolutions of support and that he only started to campaign last Thursday and garnered the numbers on Sunday.
Sa akin, hindi na natin pag-usapan yung ano, kasi lalong mauungkat-ungkat at ayaw na natin makadagdag sa kung ano man ang makakasakit. So let's move forward.
Meantime, President Marcos extended his support to newly elected Senate President Francis Escudero. On social media, Marcos said, Senator Escudero's legislative record and commitment to public service have distinguished him as a dedicated leader. He also commended the Senate leadership of Senator Juan Miguel Zubiri. Marcos is confident the upper chamber will continue to prioritize transformative laws under Escudero's leadership. The senators were invited to dinner at the palace Tuesday evening. RG Cruz, ABS-CBN News.
More accusations against controversial Tarlac Mayor Alice Go. Senator Risa Ontivero is flagging the mayor's alleged ties to big-time criminals. Citing a document from the Securities and Exchange Commission, Ontivero said two foreign nationals, including one Chinese, convicted for the largest money laundering case in Singapore, were Go's incorporators in Tarlac's Baofu compound. This is the property where the raided Pogo hub, linked to Go, used to operate. Ontiveros believes Go might have run for mayoral post to protect her friends. Go earlier claimed she divested from Baofu before running as Bamban mayor. The Senate will resume its hearing into the alleged involvement of Go into illegal Pogos in Tarlac today, May 22. Cabinet officials of former President Rodrigo Duterte accusing the Aquino administration of having an agreement in the West Philippine Sea. During a House probe on the so-called Gentleman's Agreement, former Executive Secretary Salvador Medialdia claimed a former defense chief of the late former President Ninoy Aquino committed to only deliver food and water to the BRP Sierra Madre, Manila's lone Navy post in the West Philippine Sea. He added this agreement was only continued by the Duterte administration, but lawmakers are doubtful of Medialdea's claims.
The status quo at the Ayungan Shoals, where BRP Sierra Madre, a dilapidated warship, has, which has served as a Philippine military outpost in a low elevation reef since 1999, was in a 2013 commitment of former Defense Secretary Gasmin to the Chinese Ambassador Ma Keqing that he would only deliver food and water to the Marines stationed at the vessel.
We can't help but express our surprise. Yung commitment, if any, first and foremost, in 2013, was premised on the fact na wala pa namang arbitration ruling. And in 2016, when the arbitration ruling came out, explicitly saying na meron pa tayong exclusive sovereign rights over exclusive economic zone, hindi po binago yung supposed status quo. Because I think if that were the case po, no, dapat we would have postured our foreign policy anchored on the PCA ruling.
Duterte earlier admitted he agreed with the Chinese President Xi Jinping to maintain the status quo in the West Philippine Sea, but his former officials denied having knowledge of the deal.
Being a lawyer, knew fully well that it was foolhardy to enter into an agreement, especially a gentleman's agreement at that, with the President of the People's Republic of China on matters involving sovereign rights.
There was no secret agreement, as far as I know, and as far as I can remember.
The massive data breach at the Firearms and Explosives Office of the Philippine National Police, now considered a national security concern. The hackers stole 1.5 terabytes of data affecting over 500,000 Filipinos. Information and Communications Technology Undersecretary Jeffrey D says the stolen information include those of politicians and government officials, including himself.
A lot of our important personalities whose lives are also in danger or there are or receiving death threats owns firearms. We are talking about judges, we're talking about prosecutors, most of our politicians also, right? I myself am a responsible gun owner, so my records are inside. This is a data breach that we are taking very, very seriously, and the PNP knows that. And that's why we're approaching this not only from a PNP side, but now as a whole of government. It is safe to say that this is a national security concern due to the personalities involved.
D is hopeful they will soon catch the perpetrator. Cybersecurity expert Art Samaniego says the person behind the PNP data breach is one of the most prolific hackers in the country.
At first, he would like to portray himself as as someone who hates the oligarch. He said they wanted to attack the oligarch, they wanted to attack the elite. But then suddenly they attack the group. They call themselves op-edsa. They attack government institutions which are not elite like the DOST. Hindi naman elite yung DOST. Mm-mm. They deleted data. Mm. So from then on, I think their goal changed. Now they're just exploiting government agencies that are vulnerable. Mm. So gaya nito, they saw that the PNP and the DOST, they have the same vulnerability.
Mm-mm.
You know, sabi niya, it's not the security of the sites. The security is okay. But what's the problem here is that it's the human error.
Mm.
That's the cause of the breach.
The Philippine peso breaches the 58 to the dollar level for the first time in nearly 2 years. The local currency closed at 58.27 to the greenback on Tuesday. It has now lost about 4% against the dollar since the start of the year. The Philippine Central Bank reiterated its view. This continues to be a case of a stronger dollar amid a delay in rate cuts from the Federal Reserve. The BSP assured the public it's keeping a close watch on the foreign exchange market and said it would take steps if needed to ease volatility. One analyst meanwhile says inflation and geopolitical tensions are among the factors that may further move the peso down.
The BSP is hinting that they might cut rate earlier than the Fed, especially if inflation is tamed. That might also weaken the currency because of the interest rate differential. If the rates in the Philippines are going to be lower, then I might as well put it in the US. The inflation and to the extent oil, because we are importing almost all our oil requirements. So that can influence the peso greatly because, again, it depends on our requirements. Finally, I think it's the geopolitical tension, which is beyond everyone's control. Nobody can actually forecast that and make assumptions as to what is going to be happening in the Middle East and probably other countries.
Now let's get an update on the weather from PAGASA forecaster Veronica Torres. Good morning, Veronica.
Good morning, Ms. Bettina, and to all of our audience in ANC. Currently, easterlies is still affecting the country and we're expecting partly cloudy to cloudy skies with isolated rain showers or thunderstorms over Metro Manila and the rest of the country. As of now, we don't have any gale warning raised over any parts of the country. And although we are not monitoring any low pressure area or tropical cyclone near inside the Philippine area of responsibility, we are not ruling out the possible formation of a low pressure area in the next hours or in the next coming days. And that's the latest from PAGASA Weather Forecasting Center. Veronica C. Torres reporting.
Thank you very much for that update, Veronica. An update now on the Singapore Airlines flight that encountered severe turbulence Tuesday night. A 73-year-old British man died while dozens more were injured in the incident. The plane was about 10 hours into a flight from London to Singapore when it was diverted to Bangkok. Five Filipinos were among the 211 passengers on the flight. 18 crew members were also on board. A hospital in Bangkok said at least 71 people were hurt, with six seriously injured. No word yet if Filipinos were among those wounded. In a statement, the CEO of Singapore Airlines apologized for the trauma experienced by all the passengers and the crew of the flight. He adds they are providing all possible assistance to those affected by the incident. Former U.S. President Donald Trump opts not to testify in his Hasmani trial, bringing his defense to a quick conclusion. This clears the way for the jury to begin deliberations next week. Trump had stoked speculations for weeks whether he would take the stand to defend himself. Criminal defendants typically do not testify in their own trials, as it exposes them to probing questions from prosecutors. Trump would also have been at risk for perjury if he lied under oath. Trump's son, Donald Jr., joined supporters outside the courthouse to rail against the trial.
What's going on here is an absolute farce, and anyone in America should be embarrassed at the absolute miscarriage of justice that we're seeing here.
Yeah, all the rights here go to the defendant because it's his liberty at stake, and that has not been happening in this courtroom. So let's just pray that we have jurors that see through this.
I can tell you, these charges should have never been brought. There's no crime.
Trump has pleaded not guilty to falsifying business records to cover up hush money payment to adult film star Stormy Daniels before the 2016 presidential elections. Protesters interrupt U.S. Secretary of State Anthony Blinken as he began offering testimony before the Senate Foreign Relations Committee on Washington's Israel policy. Several were evicted, including one who approached Blinken from behind, waving a sign that says criminal. Blinken reiterated the Biden administration's support for Israel, but insists it was focused on easing the humanitarian crisis in Gaza.
In the Middle East, we're standing with Israel in its efforts to ensure that what happened on October 7th never happens again, as we do everything we can to bring an end to the terrible human suffering in Gaza and prevent the conflict from spreading.
Blinken also expressed his belief that a ceasefire deal was still possible, but charged that the International Criminal Court's arrest bid for Israeli leaders was setting back diplomatic efforts. Let's find out what stories our North America Bureau is pursuing right now from our correspondent, Henny Espinosa.
Hey guys, here are news making headlines for Filipinos in North America.
Jessica, we begin in the San Francisco Bay Area, where hundreds of California Republicans recently gathered to prepare for the 2024 presidential election, hoping to bring former President Donald Trump back to the White House. They say due to progressive policies in California, many are finding themselves aligning with conservatives.
I think people would be hard-pressed to find one single thing that the Democrat Party is actually doing in this state. Everything is a failure. We have everything costs too much, there's too much crime, too many homeless people.
Republicans also say that the U.S. and the Philippines will be better off with Trump reelected in November.
Starting on foreign affairs, we're not going to see Russia and China expand and be as reckless as they have. We had 4 years of peace and tranquility with Donald Trump. Under Biden, it's been a disaster. The entire Southeast Asia is under threat with China. I think we're going to see that turn around dramatically.
California has not gone red in a presidential race since 1988 between then Vice President George Bush and then Massachusetts Governor Michael Dukakis. Meanwhile, in sports, some of the country's top Asian American athletes celebrated Asian American Pacific Heritage Month on the basketball court in Manhattan Beach, California. Amazing HQ held its annual All-Star West Showcase, bringing in some of the top Filipino-American basketball talents. Among those jamming out for the day-long celebration, Dylan Harper, who has been considered as a top two-ranked high school basketball player in the country. The New Jersey native will be attending Rutgers in the fall. It was a family day for the Harpers, as his brother Ron Harper Jr., the fourth Filipino to make it in the NBA, and their Bataan-born mother, Maria Pizarro Harper, one of the first Filipinas to play U.S. Division I basketball, also took part in the panel and coached the All-Star Games. Dylan, who was recently named the Jordan Classic MVP, scored 38 points in Amazing's Boys Showcase. Also representing Pinoy Pride was recent USC graduate Kyla Padilla, fresh from her NCAA tournament run, and victorious VJ Miller, a top 10 ranked shooting guard from California heading to Louisiana State University. A total of 11 Division I college-bound Asian American players took part in the events, hoping to empower Asian athletes. Amazing will now bring its All-Star East along with more Elite Hoops talent showcase to York University in Toronto, Ontario, Canada on Sunday, May 26th. And finally in entertainment news, film and Broadway star Eva Noblezada and her musical The Great Gatsby won big at the 2024 Broadway.com Audience Choice Awards in New York City on Monday. The Great Gatsby is this year's favorite new musical, with Noblezada and Jeremy Jordan winning in the favorite leading actress and actor categories. While the musical Merrily We Roll Along is this year's biggest winner with 5 wins, including Favorite Musical Revival, and all 3 of its stars winning in different categories. Jonathan Groff, Favorite Performance of the Year, Daniel Radcliffe, Favorite Featured Actor, and Lindsay Mendez, Favorite Featured Actress. Winners will be honored at a special private reception at 48 Lounge on June 6th in New York City.
And those are the newsmaking headlines today. You can catch more TFC News on the ABS-CBN News website, YouTube channel, and app. I'm Henny Espinosa. Back to you guys at the Rundown.